Welcome to the world of the door slammer, where you don't want to get caught looking out the window. ESPN, the world leader in motorsports coverage, presents Speed World. On a beautiful summer afternoon, the International Hot Rod Association makes its New England debut at the first annual Caribe Sun Care Products Northeast Nitrous Nationals. Hello once again, everyone. I'm Bob Barsha. For the first time in our ESPN Speed World coverage of the International Hot Rod Association, we've come to New England, to one of the finest quarter-mile strips in the country, New England Dragway. This weekend, we feature the Northeast Nitrous Nationals, and later on this summer, we'll be back for a full-fledged IHRA national event, the North American Nationals. And there's an important distinction there. To explain more, we turn to ESPN drag racing analyst Ted Jones. Ted, let's talk about the difference between the Nitrous classes and the Nitro cars.
Well, Bob, the names are very similar in their sound, but believe me, that's all that's similar. You see, nitromethane is a fuel, a very powerful fuel, used by the Nitro funny cars and the top fuelers. Nitrous oxide, on the other hand, is an oxidizer or an additive to add oxygen to gasoline. Now, you can burn all the gas you can and make a lot of horsepower if you can add oxygen to it. So, nitrous oxide has a lot of oxygen in it. You add that to the combustion chamber, dump in more gasoline, the end result is more energy. That makes more horsepower, which makes more speed.
And a great show at the start line as well. For more on qualifying for today's event, now let's get down to the big end and Brett Kepner.
Well, gentlemen, the racers who made the long tow to Epic, New Hampshire found out that this is some of the best air quality they've had a chance to race in since the season opening Winter Nationals. In fact, with a little bit of high humidity, other than that, the temperatures have been extremely constant, and that has made for some of the best conditions we've seen this season. I should point out that this quarter mile racetrack is also one of the smoothest and longest these racers have had a chance to compete on this year. With the air quality right now actually a little better than it was in the second half of qualifying, we could see some tremendous numbers here today in Pro Stock, Pro Modified, and Pro Alcohol Funny Car. What are the weather conditions, Bob? It feels pretty good out here right now.
Feels good indeed, Brett. We're about an hour's drive north of Boston. We've got 85 degrees and very low humidity. A beautiful day here in New England. Of course, no stop on the IHRA Tour would be complete without the Scotchgard Automotive Protectors 3M Night of Fire. In Pro Modified, Scotty Cannon went up against Bill Kuhlman and turned in some amazing numbers, Ted.
Well, nobody's going to stop Scotty Cannon. What a season he's having. Number one qualifier at this event in his Lumina Z34 with a 666.
And 207 miles an hour, both of them top performances in qualifying. In Pro Stock, Billy Huff, coming in as the points leader, wound up as number one qualifier, but you couldn't tell it from this run, Ted.
Huff had a problem on the final qualifying round against Sherry Kemp. Huff had to shut it down. Sherry Kemp went on through to a 727 at 192, and that wasn't good enough to make the field.
Hard to believe those kinds of numbers don't make the show. In Alcohol Funny Car, the local favorites make good. From Northfield, Connecticut, Rich Fenwick, top qualifier.
Fenwick stunned the crowd with a 601, 222 miles per hour to be number one qualifier, and had them all talking to themselves.
A great night under the stars. ESPN coverage of the Caribe Sun Care Products Northeast Nitrous Nationals is brought to you by Pennzoil, America's number one selling motor oil for performance, protection, and quality. And by GMC Truck, the strength of experience. We'll be back for eliminations in Pro Modified when we return to Epping, New Hampshire. Welcome back to New England Dragway. Bob Barsha and Ted Jones with you as we get set for round one in Pro Modified eliminations. Our first matchup, Dennis Fitz against Norman Estes. Estes already a winner this season. Fitz still looking for that first victory.
Well, Fitz, the local star from Norwich, Connecticut, and having a little bit of handling difficulties. Look at those two treads of rubber down the drag strip. Estes to an easy win at 6.95.
So the man from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, comes through with a first round victory. Our next matchup in the far lane, Bill Kuhlman from Wentzville, Missouri, against Rich Beaumont, another local favorite, Wallingford, Connecticut.
Well, the locals trying to fare well in this tough pro modify class, but not against Big Bill Coolman as he runs the Summit Automotive car through to a 692, 201 miles per hour.
And he might have hurt the engine. Now, here's a new wrinkle. This is Al Billis, who's already a winner this year with something new under the hood.
For 2.5 full seasons at IHRA competition, the ProMod controversy has raged on and on and on. Nitrous oxide injection versus superchargers, the blower versus the bottle. Now, Al Billis, one of the last standouts of nitrous oxide injection here at the Caribe Sun Care Products Northeast Nitrous Nationals, unveils another supercharged ProMod power plant. A lot of people were pretty shocked when Al Billis attempted to debut his supercharged power plant without a timed run during the first qualifying session here, but when the very first run down the quarter mile netted a 6.74, most of the pro mod racers that still rely on nitrous simply groaned.
Yeah, it's something we've been thinking about for a long time, but this year we wanted to wait and see what happened with Scotty Cannon, and he made the move successfully, so we decided we'd try it as well.
Was that a primary concern, that a successful nitrous racer could adapt to this type of power plant, or were you just looking to see how quick he could go?
Well, I knew both. I knew if Scotty would switch over and he'd run well, then I knew it'd work well. So we waited, we saw that happen, and we decided to make the move as well.
Well, on the same line then, what was the biggest holdback to stick with the nitrous motor?
Time and money. It's always the two factors. When you do finally decide to do it, which is after Darlington, it takes a lot of time to get the car sorted out, get all the pieces for the engine, get them together, get them working, and it's already the middle of the season.
Is this a situation like Bill Coolman has created in that you can still switch back to a nitrous motor if the situation arises?
Yeah, we can, but I don't want to have to switch at a race. I really don't want to.
You've seen Bill Coolman work his crew into the ground on that.
That's a lot of work. That's a bunch of work. That's too bad.
You really honestly think this is a big step in dominance? The 674 was a surprise even to you.
Yeah, it was. The mile per hour surprised me as well. I've never run that fast. That was 3 miles per hour quicker than I've ever run before.
At 206, I believe.
Yeah, that's quite a change.
And I guess you're probably going to tell me that you weren't leaning on it, right?
No, we weren't.
Still lots left, right?
Yeah, I hope so.
Well, there it is from Jim Oddie's shops, a supercharged engine for Al Billis. And if anybody can make the switch, this college-trained engineer who has worked on Indy cars can do it. He's going up against Danbury, Connecticut's Steve Gabriel.
Well, the controversy will really rage on now, Bob, between the blown and the nitrous guys, especially if Billis can end up winning this event.
Nitrous car for Gabriel. Oh, Gabriel's slow off the line. He is broken. Let's see how quick Al Billis can go.
Not used to the blower, he lifted early. 691, 182. The speed's indicative of the fact that he lifted early.
Here's another look now from on board with Al Billis.
You want to watch when he lifts, watch the tachometer in the center of your screen.
To let go of the Lenko there to straighten up the car. Now there is Scotty Cannon, the defending world champion, on a bye run in the first round. Let's see his numbers.
Oh, what a bye run. 671, 207 miles per hour. Scotty's dial kill.
Matching the times he put up in the qualifying, Scotty Cannon will meet Billy Harper in the next round, Bill Coolman and Norman Estes, Al Billis and Ed Burnley. Now it's time for round one action in pro stock. No blowers or nitrous here. Pump gasoline through four-barreled carburetors in the far lane, the defending world champion, Doug Kirk. In the near lane, Robert McDonald.
Well, young Doug Kirk on a rip on this run. Looks like he has him on top in. Yes, sir. Half a car length, 721, 195 miles per hour.
Our next matchup pits Todd Tutterow from Louisville, North Carolina against Tim Nabors from Lawrenceville, Georgia.
Tim Nabor with a real man's mountain motor, 762 cubic inches of Chevy power. However, Tutterow pulls the victory out with a 719.
And that will hurt Tim Nabors definitely on the downhill slide this season. You can see him leaving tracks all the way down the top end, but just didn't have enough at the line. One more look from our ESPN photo finish camera. It was that close. Now here is Steve Willifer, the contender for the world championship and a man who's been putting up some incredible top speed numbers lately. Here's Brett with more.
1992 has been the year of the 200-mile-per-hour pro stocker. At the season-opening Winter Nationals, we saw Ricky Smith run an official double-century pass, and then Carlton Phillips came up with a 200.08-mile-per-hour time trial. But since then, no one's been able to break the double-century mark, mostly in part due to the weather. But here at the inaugural edition of the Caribe Sun Care Products Northeast Nitrous Nationals, this particular machine, the 1990 World Championship Pro Stock entry in IHRA, has been the subject of some of the hottest controversy since this class had its first-ever 200-mile-an-hour effort. During time trials and qualifying at this event, this machine, the Williford Farms Sonny Leonard-powered Pontiac Trans Am, ran speeds of 203 and 205 miles per hour. Now, if you talk to the pro stock drivers in the pit area at this event, most of them will tell you they flat simply do not believe that the car is capable of running that number. But there are so many different elements that have gone into these controversial figures that one has to look at it from all angles. First of all, the engine in this car, a 747 cubic inch Sonny Leonard power plant, one of two identical engines the team has. But their B motor, as they call their backup entry, will only go about 192 miles per hour. This run, this engine, two consecutive passes of 203 and 205. One also has to look at the fact that this car has gone faster than just about any other pro stock at almost every other IHRA event this year, including runs of 197 miles an hour at Scribner, Nebraska, 4 miles an hour faster than anybody else, and back-to-back 199 mile per hour passes at the recent Empire Nationals. The question is, if the car is running basically the same engine, basically the same rear end gear, basically the same size tire, and going through the finish line lights at the same RPM as everybody else, why is this car going 10 miles an hour faster than everybody else? There is one other theory as to what could possibly cause these high speeds. There's a phenomenon in pro stock and pro modified drag racing known as the nose slam, in which the nose is pushed down by 200 mile per hour aerodynamic forces to actually trip the second beam that stops the speed clock at the finish line early. Here's how it works. The car will go through the finish line lights and break an electronic light beam with the front tire located 66 feet before the finish line. Then, theoretically, this same front tire should break the beam 66 foot later that stops the speed clock. The clock computes the average speed over that 66-foot distance. But there's a way that it can be tricked into believing that the car is going faster. And that's if the front tire breaks that first beam, then air pressure forces the nose down and the second beam is broken by the front end of this car. Now, there's about 23 inches from the front of the tire to the front of the nose on this car. But based on the foot per second rate of a finish line pro stocker, 200 miles per hour, it's interesting to note that in order to go 205 miles per hour, the car would still have had to go through the lights legitimately at almost 202. So no matter how you look at it, this car is going fast. And until somebody can prove why the car isn't really going 205 miles per hour, the International Hot Rod Association will have to continue to rely on its certified CompuLink computer timers.
All a part of the magic and mystery of drag racing. Thank you, Brett. Steve Williford goes to the line in the car that Tommy Mooney took to a world championship. His opponent, Joe Folgore from Colts Rock, New Jersey.
Well, while Folgore is not a regular on the IHRA trail, we've seen him before. He is to be reckoned with, Bob.
In fact, these two cars very evenly matched in horsepower. Only 3 cubic inches of displacement separate them. Williford got a great start, but got sideways. Now he's going to have to try to make it up, and he won't do it.
Williford with some tire spin. Joe Folgore, 731. But look at this. Williford went a 761 at 200 mile per hour. The mysterious speed continues.
Now here comes Carlton Phillips against Charlie Garrett Jr. Phillips with the biggest engine in the class. 786 cubic inches, and he gets it done.
711, 195 miles per hour. Now that speed makes more sense. Look at this run one more time as Carlton Phillips goes through at a 711 at 195. You talk about close drag racing.
Here's another look from our photo finish camera. Right there, Carlton Phillips got by. So Billy Huff will meet Terry Walter, Jim Revis, Joe Folgore, Doug Kirk and Harold Denton will have at it, and Carlton Phillips will meet Todd Tutterow when we return to Epic New Hampshire Alcohol Funny Cars. Stay with us. Back at the Northeast Nitrous Nationals, we're ready to do a little vintage racing. Here's Brett Kepner.
In 1955, Chevrolet debuted the Bel Air Series, and the original 210 hardtops that came equipped with a 265 cubic inch Chevy V8 engine immediately became some of the quickest and fastest factory available machines in the United States. Some 30 years later, the 1955 Chevy Bel Air may still be one of the most popular body styles ever to hit the drag strip, but in the 1960s and 70s, it was still the mainstay of the high performance enthusiast machinery. But now it's 1992, and things are obviously different every way around in drag racing. But some things never change, including the International Harvard Association's unusual funny car body rule that allows any year body style to compete on an even keel with the late model aerodynamic entries. This incredible piece of equipment is Jim Lape's Pennsylvania-based 1955 Chevy Bel Air Pro Alcohol funny car that is indeed one of the biggest engineering masterpieces of the 1992 IHRA season. How much work did it take to try and keep to the stock appearance?
Quite a bit. It took five of us 5 months of extensive work, lots of late nights to come up with what we have here.
I guess I have to presume that you used an original 55 Chevy for the body mold, right?
More or less we did, yeah. We used a plug out of another mold and just extensively changed it to come up with a 55.
One thing that a lot of people realize right off the bat is the fact that you're trying to run competitively in the Pro Alcohol Funny Car class. But let's face it, the front end of this car is anything but aerodynamic. You left it in its stock barn door configuration. Why?
There again, it looks better that way, and I think it can still be competitive to some extent.
What's the biggest thing you hear from the crowd as they see this car for the first time?
They like the appearance of the car. They like the fact that it does look like it's supposed to.
Well, let's see if it runs like it's supposed to. An alcohol funny car quarterfinal action. Here comes Jim Lape from Meyertown, Pennsylvania. And the crowd reacts to this car, Ted, just the way they did to Tom the Mongoose McEwen's 57 Chevy Nitro Funny.
Well, they say the 55 Chevy is the second most popular car behind the 57, so it's not surprising. But what a guy to draw. The world champion, Mark Thomas, with the ethanol backing. That's a tough road to hoe for Jim Lape.
Jim Lape with that period piece in the background up against state of the art. Mark Thomas, two-time alcohol funny car world champion from Louisville, Ohio. Good launch for both cars. Lape bounces the front end, but he holds Thomas close. He won't get him.
Thomas takes the victory with a 6'11", 228, but a good showing by Jim Lape. Remember, he's pushing a box down through there.
Aerodynamically, you're right, it's an absolute brick, but boy, he really gives the world champion a run for his money here. Watch the left lane, there's the porpoising.
Nice driving job, he holds the car straight and true though, and remember, when that front end comes up, he has no steering, so he's really set the car up well.
Elsewhere in the round, the number one qualifier, Rich Fenwick, went up against Ronnie Taylor from Shrewsbury, Massachusetts. In the right lane, Taylor with all kinds of problems, but he held Fenwick close.
Fenwick was supposed to win. Remember, he's the number one qualifier. He does pick up the victory with a 6.51, 220 miles per hour.
Leaving long black streaks of rubber all the way down the drag strip. Bob Sweet from Sterling, Massachusetts, went up against the Canadian entry from Larry Dobbs.
Dobbs has one of the mountain motors in there, 541 cubic inches of Keith Black power, but it wasn't enough. Bob Sweet picked up this victory with a 6.17, 229 miles per hour. He's in this race, Bob.
And our final matchup, an alcohol funny car, Paul Johnson from Massachusetts up against Scott Weiss. Watch the right lane. Weiss smoking the tires, but keeps his foot in it. Problems for Johnson in the left lane. Weiss even pulls the chute and manages to drag it across the line to win.
Weiss has to wonder how he won this one, but look at the ET, 644, 162, not bad for having all those problems.
Rich Fenwick, the number one qualifier, will meet Mark Thomas in the semis. Bob Sweet up against Scott Weiss. Now let's find out about Paul Johnson.
Very unfortunate situation. We had that nickel-dime piece break on us, the throttle cable of all things.
That's why it shut off. It didn't shut off, it just stopped running.
I think the car was probably on the best run of the weekend. We had run an 11 in qualifying to qualify in the third position, and we felt the car had a lot more. The car has run O's before on numerous occasions.
Exactly. I was going to say, from our vantage point, it's difficult to tell. Did you actually get around him and then it broke, or were you in pursuit and it broke?
I would have to say that we were side by side until we got the car in high gear, and I was pulling away from him clearly, and then just that's what happened.
That'll be disgusting feeling.
That's drag racing.
Right, it was crazy. I left starting line, the car was really motoring hard, and about half track, the car just filled up with smoke. Inside, had no clue as to what was going on, hit the fire extinguisher, shut it off, coasted through, waiting for him to come by at any moment, and he didn't.
It's been a rough couple of weeks here on parts for you guys.
It really has. We've lost four motors in five races, and we just, you know, we've gone to the final round three times, as you know, but it just can't keep losing motors the way we are.
Well, Lady Luck was riding with you on this one. I know you got work to go. Go ahead.
Next round it is. Thanks, Brett.
A wild afternoon continues at Epping, New Hampshire. We'll be back for quarterfinal action in Pro Stock.
Sun Care products, Northeast Nitrous Nationals, quarterfinal action in pro stock is on deck. Here's our first look at Jim Revis. A 91 old Cutlass, 745 cubic inches of Pontiac power for the veteran. Number 8 in points coming in. Going up against Joe Fulgore, who knocked off Steve Williford in the first round.
Well, Fulgore is not capable of sub-7-second times, but Jim Revis is. At any given moment, he can take off and run right at the top of the field, Bob.
Revis in the running for the world championship. Definitely doesn't need an upset in the second round here in Epping, New Hampshire. Good launch for both cars. Fulgore carrying the wheels just a little bit. Now Fulgore drops back with mechanical problems. Give it to Revis.
Revis with a 721, 194 miles per hour to pick up an easy victory, as Fulgore did have problems.
Now here is the man that Revis is chasing in the points. Number 7 coming in from Middlesex, North Carolina, Harold Denton in the Party Time Pontiac. His opponent, just the defending world champion from Lenoir, West Virginia, Doug Kirk.
Both of these cars capable of winning at this point in time. Remember, Harold Denton, the first guy to ever go in the sixes. However, young Doug Kirk is plenty quick.
Kirk's second in points, but he's losing at half track to Harold Denton, and he loses the race.
Not surprising. Harold Denton, a 7-11, 196 miles per hour. The Ruth brothers have that thing humming.
There you see Kirk getting away very cleanly. I think he actually has Harold Denton off the launch pad. But somehow Denton comes on before they reach half track. Had him by half a car length. Let's see how close it was at the finish.
Denton had to have tremendous horsepower because he really got a gate job put on him by Kirk. And you can see he pulled him by a full car length.
And now here comes Carlton Phillips in his beautifully turned out Chevy Lumina with the biggest V8 engine ever built out of General Motors blocks, 786 cubic inches. His opponent from Louisville, North Carolina, this man, Todd Tutterow, with an 89 Pontiac Trans Am, 732 cubic inches.
Tutterow, one of the guys that came up from the old IHRA factory modified class, did very well there.
And doing well here. In fact, he gets the whole shot on Carlton Phillips. The yellow car in the right lane has Phillips at half track and beats him.
Todd Tutterow picks it up with a 7-17. Carlton Phillips turned a 7-13. Carlton was really asleep on the line with that one.
Carlton Phillips, winner of the Summer Nationals in Cayuga, Ontario, Canada, gets knocked off here in the second round. A big step up for Todd Tutterow, number 4 in points, and looking for a title. Now let's take a look at Carlton Phillips' run with the computers in our IHRA benchmark, Ted.
All right, down the left side of the screen, you'll be seeing the RPMs rise in thousands. Across the bottom of the screen will be elapsed time in seconds as the car goes down the drag strip. Carlton left the line at about 4,500 RPMs. You'll see the gear changes with the sharp peaks across the top of your screen. Also, a problem in second and third gear. You see the stutter right there? That's something we don't want. Now, the drive shaft RPM will attempt to look at the tire spin. He leaves the line at just over 1,000 RPMs. You'll see a little bit of tire spin at a second and a half and a little bit up there at about 3 seconds. Other than that, he had a pretty good run. Let's take a look now at the clutch on Carlton's pass. At about the 1 second mark, it looks pretty good there again, though, in second gear and third gear, just a little bit of spin.
That's our IHRA benchmark in Carlton Phillips' losing effort. Now here is our final matchup in the quarterfinals of Pro Stock. Billy Huff leading the championship, coming in out of Shepherdsville, Kentucky. And there is his opponent, Terry Walters from Roanoke, Virginia, number 19 in points coming in, but he could be a spoiler.
747 cubic inches, that's a normal motor nowadays.
Walters has 747, 754 in Billy Huff's car. Good launches for both drivers, but Walters loses ground all the way down.
Billy Huff picks up the victory, a 714, 197 miles per hour.
By virtue of the quicker ET, Billy Huff will have lane choice in the semis against Jim Revis. Harold Denton will lock horns with Todd Tutterow. When we return, we will have quarterfinal action in Pro Modified. Stand by for more door slammer action. At Epping, New Hampshire, fire is always a racer's worst enemy. Here's Brett Kepner with more on a pioneering effort to fight fire.
While Pro Modified as a category has one of the cleanest safety records in drag racing, it's interesting to note that when Albello switched to a supercharged power plant in his Pro Modified Camaro, he installed these twin 10-pound fire extinguishing system bottles. Now, any supercharged engine in any type of vehicle is going to pose a potential safety hazard, but it's interesting to note that right now the International Harvard Association has not mandated a fire system like this, not unlike those used in nitro funny cars, in this category yet, but many drivers believe they probably should before 1993 even gets underway. Certainly Albello is concerned with the safety situation with these bottles behind him, but if nothing else, he's leading the way to a possible new rules revision in Pro Modified.
Nothing wrong with the rules revision in the name of safety. We are ready now for Pro Modified quarterfinals. There is Norman Estes from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, twice a winner this year in Canada at the Summer Nationals and more recently in the Empire Nationals in Rochester, New York. And there is the Summit Racing Camaro of the man who pioneered the Pro Modified class, Bill Kuhlman from Wentzville, Missouri.
Well, Kuhlman, capable of switching back and forth, and it looks right now as though he's got the nitrous oxide engine on board. Because of the hood scoop, I don't think the blower is under there. So it'll be two nitrous-injected cars.
The war continues between the nitrous-boosted ranks and the supercharged cars. Both cars stage together. They are away. Estes gets sideways. Looks like Kuhlman has about a fender on him at half track.
Nice driving job by Estes, a 6.92.04. Boy, was that a tight run. We've got to look at it one more time.
Both cars carrying the front wheels. Estes on the right in the yellow car, much more than Bill Kuhlman. And I got to tell you, I thought Kuhlman had this one drilled at half track. Let's watch it now as they come down to the finish. Estes just drives around him by that much. Whoa.
Both cars going over 200 miles per hour. It took a photo finish to decide this one.
Now let's get on board with Bill Kuhlman. Our onboard camera is clean, so we'll just clean off the specs.
You can see how calm, cool, and collected he is inside the cockpit of that car as he takes and wipes his eyes off and puts the glasses back on one more time. Now Beth Kuhlman telling him where the staging lights are.
Beth lines up Bill. This is our onboard camera looking out the window over at Norman Estes. Starter Jim Blakely looking nonchalant as Bill goes through the procedures. Watches the tree, looking up and down. This camera is mounted on his helmet, so you'll look in whatever direction Bill looks during the run. Right now, there's the tree outside the windshield. Now looking sideways at Esty. Holding steady, holding steady. Here's where Bill had the advantage, and that's where he lost it.
Isn't that incredible what happens at 200 miles per hour? You see how quickly that car left him.
Elsewhere in the round, Al Villas, a winner this year on tour, went up against Ed Burnley. And Burnley, number 31 in points coming in, as opposed to number two, Al Villas, left Villas at the starting line.
Well, he had a gate job on him, but it wasn't good enough as Burnley had some ill-handling problems all over the track. Finally had to shut it down. Al Villas on a cruise. He'll pick up the victory at 722-197.
Now here is the man who has been everything in Pro Mod this year. A few last-minute adjustments on the Chevrolet Lumina Z34 supercharged car of Scotty Cannon, the Cannonball.
Cannon out of Lyman, South Carolina, has everybody on the run. He's up against Billy Harper in this particular round.
Harper out of Paducah, Kentucky, with a replica 68 Plymouth Barracuda. He's got Cannon big time off the tree, but here comes Scotty.
Incredible driving job, 683, 206 miles per hour, and Scotty took a nap. Look at that hole shot for Billy Harper. That's incredible that Scotty can drive around him.
Beat him by nearly 0.2 of a second, and that is an eternity in drag racing. Now here is the top end charge of the Cannonball.
Well, Harper only ran a 7.03, and that's the only way Scotty pulled this out, Bob.
And only just as you can see. Boy, this is close.
That much.
So Scotty Cannon will advance to meet Norman Estes in a battle of previous round winners on tour. Al Villas will have a bye run in the semifinals. Big crowd enjoying itself in the IHRA debut in New England. Let's take a look at the sportsman results, Ted.
Well, we had plenty of local stars on hand, and they gave the regulars a lot of trouble, except in top dragster. Larry Plummer, one of the IHRA stars in top dragster, a winner, and in modified, Ampito. Other than that, they were all local stars that showed the IHRA guys the way home.
Obviously, the IHRA has plenty of reason to come back here in seasons to come. The folks up here like their drag racing. When we come back, alcohol, funny cars, semi Stay with us. We are back in Epping, New Hampshire, and we would certainly be remiss if we didn't give you a little taste of the scenery here in the heart of New England vacation country. Barely an hour's drive north of Boston. It's easy to see why folks love to come up this way. It's easy to see why the regulars on the International Hot Rod Association Championship Trail are going to be coming to New England Dragway for many seasons to come. All of these pictures, I should note, were taken just minutes from the racetrack. Back on the racetrack, we are ready for alcohol funny cars. We have semi-final action coming up. Two great pairings. First up in alcohol funny cars, Rich Fenwick, the number one qualifier, will go up against Mark Thomas, the two-time world champion.
Well, don't count Thomas out yet. This guy seems to always pull through no matter where he qualifies. That's why he's a world champion.
Fenwick, unranked in tour points, hailing from Northfield, Connecticut. Mark Thomas, number one in points, coming in looking for that third world title. Looks like Thomas might have him, and he does.
Wow, what a driving job by Mark Thomas. 6:15, 228. That car was out of shape, and Mark managed to straighten it out for the victory.
In the other half of the brackets, Bob Sweet up against Scott Weiss. Watch the right lane, jumping the start. Red light for Bob Sweet. Scott Weiss with an automatic berth in the finals against Mark Thomas. And by virtue of the quicker ET, he will have lane choice when he meets the world champ. Now it's time for a regular feature on our IHRA broadcast, Hot Rod Shop. Here's Brett Kepner to tell you about how they keep the fire in those cylinders.
Regardless of the amount of modifications performed to an engine, the one thing that's going to matter most is whether or not you can seal each cylinder's compression and combustion with a set of piston rings. And one of the people that knows probably most about compression and combustion is Bill Coleman with the Summer Racing Equipment Chevy Camaro. And Bill, a piston ring may look like just one standard piece of equipment, but they come in different shapes, sizes, and mostly materials.
Exactly. You know, we use SpeedPro rings on our engine because we found that those things are the most compatible to the type of abuse we want to put them through. They're different type of rings. They don't look that different than what you put in your family vehicle, but they definitely are. They're made out of different materials and there's different styles.
Now, as far as the difference in materials, is the type of material used in the racing type piston ring adaptable to a street car?
At times it can be, although it may cause a little premature cylinder wall wear. In other words, a racing ring is a hard, molly surfaced ring. Some guys use it on the street, but it may give a little premature engine wear. But in the race car, since we update the engine so often, we're not concerned with that.
Now, as far as sealing compression, are there adjustable types of rings that can be expanded or compressed for different sizes as the cylinder wears?
Brett, what we have here is the ultimate sealing ring. They use these in top fuel quite a bit in blown alcohol applications. It's called a Dyke's top ring. It may not have that great leak down number that a lot of guys look for, but under compression, these things really jump out and bite the wall. What you have there is your standard cast second ring. It's a backup for the top ring, and it's a backup for the oil rings, which are here. The oil rings basically look conventional, although material-wise, sometimes they can be different, and they can be in three tensions. They can be in a medium tension, a low tension, or a high tension. All three have to be gapped properly for the bore, as in any application, even on the street. All three have to be located properly to be most effective.
So if there's a gap or a hole in that combustion seal, a car can lose horsepower.
Exactly. It can not only lose horsepower, if there's a gap or hole, as you call it, and you have compression leakage, you could also have oil coming the other way. You get oil in that combustion chamber, it can lead to detonation, and detonation can damage parts. The nice thing about it is with the SpeedPro rings, you've got the quality ring there to control the whole situation. We've got $42,000 race engines we're dealing with. We put in the best rings, but the neat thing about it is these things actually aren't any higher than what you put in your actual street engine.
So obviously there are differences in piston rings, but one thing it all comes down to is the fact that this may well be one of the most important little pieces of equipment in anybody's engine.
At $42,000 a copy, I would guess so. Brett, thanks to you, thanks to Bill Kuhlman. When we come back, semifinal action in Pro Stock. Welcome back to the Caribe Sun Care Products Northeast Nitrous Nationals. Bob Barsha, Ted Jones, and Brett Kepner with you. Semi-final action in Pro Stock coming up next. Featuring the number one man in points, Billy Huff, against number eight in points, Jim Revis.
And you know, Bob, the points are important for another reason. Later on this season, the top eight qualifiers will be running in the Sunoco Pro Stock Showdown. The qualifiers, meaning the top eight point standing guys, will run in an eight-car race. We'll be carrying that for you here on ESPN later on.
And a big chunk of change will be at stake as well. Billy Huff, youngest man in the Pro Stock field at this point, goes up against Jim Revis. Good launch for both cars. Looks like Huff with a bit of an advantage at half track, but I've been wrong all day. Not this time, however.
Billy Huff, 7-12, 196 to a losing 7-25, and Huff had him off the line by about a tenth of a second.
There you see that nice clean leave in the left lane for Billy Huff. Very little smoke. Watch the right lane, though. Jim Revis' Oldsmobile laying down strips of black rubber, getting wheel spin all the way to half track. And you don't want to give Billy Huff an advantage like that. Now here comes Harold Denton, first man under 7 seconds in a Mountain Motor Pro Stock. He'll be going up against Todd Tutterow in that beautiful yellow car in the foreground. Denton number 7 in the world championship right now. Tutterow number 4.
Denton running very fast at this event. He has the Party Time Pro Stocker really honking, and Tutterow knows it. So Tutterow needs a hole shot here, because I think Denton has more ET in the car.
Wow, Tutterow needed a hole shot and he got it, but he got sideways on the launch pad. Harold Denton sleeping at the line and loses.
Todd Tutterow, a 7.21, 192. Harold turned a 7.11. He did have more ET in the car, but look at that hole shot. What a gate job he strapped on Harold Denton. A 6.19 to a 4.88 reaction time. That's a bunch in a drag race.
Classic example of how you can go faster and quicker and still lose. Here it is at the finish line. Look how close. Todd Tutterow sneaks one out. One more look from the photo finish camera.
Almost thought all this smoke down here was out of your car. It was out of Harold Denton's. Well, it was a driver's one this time. 7.21 to Harold's losing 7.11, and there were still 300s down there, so it was more than a tenth hole shot. There's Harold.
Just feels good to be down here. It's hot.
I'd say it's another final round.
That's it.
Didn't hit any seagulls this week.
No seagulls this week.
Well, 21 is not what this thing should be going. What happened on the run?
I don't know. It's all over the track down there. When I pull second gear, I feel like the car's going to turn plumb over. When I just pretty much sideways.
That violent?
Yeah.
Boy, we'll have to see what happens in the final round, but I know you can get it sorted out against Billy.
I think I can. Appreciate it.
It will be Todd Tutterow against Billy Huff in the final in Pro Stock. Huff will have lane choice, and he's got about 20 cubic inches on his opponent. Now it's time for semifinal action in Pro Mod. Here comes Scotty Cannon in the OnSat Cannonball. He will be going up against Norman Estes. This should be a great matchup. Both of these men have won before. 4 times for Cannon, twice for Estes.
Estes also needs a hole shot against Scotty Cannon. What more can we say? You can bet he's going to push that tree and push it hard, just like Tutterow did.
Estes getting better reaction times generally than Cannon, who had a .680 second reaction in the previous round. That's 2/10 off perfect, and that is a long time indeed. Supercharged car in the background, nitrous boosted car in the right lane, and red light for Estes.
Well, that's what happens when you push it too hard. He also got bent out of shape, so he would have lost anyway, but he didn't have a choice. Scotty Cannon, 676, 205 miles per hour.
Here's another look. Estes in the right lane. They stood toe-to-toe, and Norman blinked.
He didn't really have a choice. He knew Scotty had him covered. He had to try and push that tree and put a gate job on Scotty, and the big red eye caught him.
Well, a tip of the helmet where it's deserved. Scotty Cannon ran straight and true, and Brett is with him.
What's the crew saying through the helmet there?
He's watching Hal on the last run for the bye run. You know Hal's going to probably go for lane choice. So.
Well, you won a 76. It's going to take a heck of a run to beat that.
Yeah, but I've been late on the light, but it's clutch, man. This track's going to give up a little bit, I think.
That's exactly what the Pro Stock drivers were saying. And you know as well as I do that Norman Estes was pitted right next to you all weekend. And you know he wasn't asleep really at all this weekend.
Matter of fact, I helped him just last minute get his car ready. And I pulled out and I said, he ain't ready. I said, man, we're good friends. And I said, we're going to race clean. We sat there. And then when he got his car ready, we went to race.
Well, let's see what Al does here.
Okay, thanks.
All business, Scotty Cannon, but a sportsman as well. Now, here's the man he's talking about, Al Billis, who's on a bye run. He's going to have to really leg it if he's going to get lane choice. He hops a bit off the launch pad, Ted.
He needs a 6.767. He does not get it. 6.89, he loses lane choice.
Nice try, but Scotty Cannon knows those supercharged engines that much better. It'll be Cannon against Billis, Cannon with lane choice in the Pro Mod Final. Meanwhile, over in the Caribe Sun Care Products tent, a little bit of a distraction for all the fans here this weekend. While our finalists get things ready in the pits, we'll keep Brett Kepner occupied. There are trophy queens, and then there are trophy queens. Don't anybody tell Brett she's here, by the way.
End of any drag racing season in any drag racing category, this is what it all comes down to, the big number one. And nobody would know better than the man who struggled so much to win one and then came back and win a second in a row, Mark Thomas, the reigning IHRA Pro Alcohol Funny Car World Champion. But going into this Pro Alcohol Funny Car Final, there's a bit more pressure than one might see on the surface. Let's face it, the points race between Mark and Scott Weiss coming into this event was nearly a dead heat. And whoever wins this championship final will walk out of here leading the World Championship Point Series as we go into the second half of the 92 season. We talked to both drivers before the final to find out what their strategy was going into this, one of the most important races they've had to face this year.
Well, the big thing's gonna happen is what this weather's doing, and we're both gonna step our cars up hard. If either one of us smokes the tires or shakes the tires, and I really believe that we're both going to, because we're both putting all the power in we can. The thing that I'm planning on is the heat's going to go away a little bit, and the track will cool off a little bit. And if that happens, it'll take everything we've got.
Basically, we're just going to step on the combination a little bit and try to get down the track. You know, it naturally won't hold a low O pass, but I'm hoping for an 08 or 09. I think that's what it's going to take. I think the starting line advantage is going to be key.
I'll tell you, the way that the both of you leave the starting line, I don't see where either one of you could pick up that much of an advantage, maybe 200 or 300.
I think I will.
All right, thank you, Brett. You notice the memorial decal and the black stripe across the number one on Mark Thomas's car? The alcohol drivers have dedicated this race to the memory of Dick Bell, one of their number who passed away not long ago. We're ready now for the final in Pro Stock. There is Todd Tutterow in the yellow machine. His opponent, number one in points, Billy Huff.
Young Billy Huff, the real lion and upcoming star in the category, has really had everybody talking. He started it last year. He's got instant lightning reflexes off the starting line and a lot of daddy's money behind him.
Nothing wrong with that. Good launches. Huff carries the wheels just a little bit. Tutterow has him. Now they're side by side, and it's Huff.
Another victory with a 7.12, 197 miles per hour.
And he was laid off the line by 5/100ths of a second, so Billy Huff did this one driving around Tutterow.
Both cars actually had a little bit of tire spin off the starting line. It was horsepower time for the big Sonny Leonard motor as Billy Huff pulled it out, going almost 200 miles per hour.
One more look from our ESPN photo finish camera, then let's get down to Brett.
Boy, is this going to make a horse race out of the points, huh?
Oh, man. What are you talking about?
As if there's not enough pressure now, boy, it's going to be a real war from here on out. 7-12, you put it right there again at 197. Tutterow ran into the same problem he had in the previous round. It's slow to a 21 again.
Yeah, I shook a little bit again in second, and it was a little more than I had all day long. I thought, oh, no, because he was doing right beside me. He probably got me off the line. Todd, he's a killer on the lights. Yeah. And I thought, oh, no, but then I pulled another gear, and it just seemed like I was just pulling on him slowly but surely the rest of the way.
Well, that's the other thing about drag racing. These drivers always have more horsepower at their disposal than the track will hold, and that's where driving technique comes in. There is one more look at Scotty Cannon, who will go to the line against Al Billis, the second time these two have met in a final this year.
But Al Billis this time is supercharged, Bob. It's almost like running a different car. And Al Billis, for the premier appearance of the supercharged car, has been running some very impressive numbers. Not as quick as Scotty, but he's right there on his heels.
Ironically, Billis is using motors built by Jim Oddy up in West Seneca, New York. Scotty Cannon started the season with Oddy Motors, but he has changed engine builders. This should be a great matchup. Good launches. Cannon in the far lane appears to have the advantage. Now Billis has him back out of it.
Scotty Cannon had it off the line all the way through. He picks up the victory with a 682, 203.57 miles per hour.
He has been consistent all season long. One more look. Scotty Cannon with his fifth victory of the season, fattening up that already massive lead in Pro Modified World Championship points.
Left the starting line with a 2/1000th of a second reaction time. Obviously, you knew about 502 is, or 402 is what I'm telling you.
402 light?
Yeah.
Oh, man. But anyway, I like to thank my wife and my... I ain't getting good at this. I always think. You think. The more you do it, the better you get, right? I can talk to you in a fifth. Anyway, I like to thank my wife. First of all, she's taking care of the businesses at home for me. I mean, that means a lot. I couldn't even be here. On set, the whole crew, boys, Bill Barrett. But there's one good one here. I like to thank Waddy at NOS for sending me this when I got out running here the other week. He says, NOS Supercharged Air, winning use this air in final rounds only. I wonder if they're going to let me send it back to get it refilled. Thanks, Waddy.
All right, Scotty Cannon, the late Mark Donahue, would have called that an unfair advantage. And by the way, it was a 5:02 reaction time, not a 4:02. Ready now for the finals in Alcohol Funny Car. What a matchup. Scott Weiss against Mark Thomas.
And Mark Thomas has a lot of experience with final round appearances.
Weiss with the advantage off the launch pad. Now Thomas is going to have to drive around. Yes!
What a drag race. Mark Thomas, 6:13, 224 miles per hour. This is worth watching one more time.
By 13/1000th of a second, Scott Weiss beat Mark Thomas off the launch pad. Thomas had to drive around, and he did by 31/1000th of a second. This is a drag race.
6:13 to a 6:16, and that's exactly what it looks like at the finish line. Watch the photo finish. That's how close it was.
That was a drag race.
That really
that was.
That
a drag
really
race.
Was.
Fantastic.
I had no clue who won.
I'd like to
I
watch
had no
that
clue
one.
Who won. That's
the here, are the numbers. He left on you.
I can believe it.
He left on you by a little bit. He went a 16, you went a 13. It was 18/1000th in the light.
I tell you what, that was a drag race. And I tell you, Scooter's, as far as I'm concerned, one of the best up-and-coming drag races.
Now, look,
it was fun.
Let me tell you something you don't know about his prediction. Remember, we talked to you before the final, and you said that it would be a tire-shaking deal. He said that he was going to be clean as a whistle, and he was going to leave on you. He did leave on you, but he did haze the tires, so you called it right.
I tell you, we both pumped him up, and I tell you, I'm happy. That was a drag race, and I like that kind of a race because it was side-by-side. I'm looking at Scooter's car the last 300 foot, and we're nose-to-nose, and it was a drag race. I absolutely love it.
Well, I guess it's unanimous. It was a drag race, side-by-side at 225 miles an hour. We'll be back to wrap things up. A great debut for the International Hot Rod Association at New England Dragway in Epping, New Hampshire. Ted Jones, how about a look at the points?
In Pro Modified action, Scotty Cannon has made matters worse. Look at that point lead over Al Billis and Norman Estes. Scotty almost has the championship in the bag. Meanwhile, in Pro Stock, things shook up a little bit. Billy Huff on top and Tricky Ricky Smith down in number five. Real unusual position for Ricky. In Alcohol Funny Car, it looks like Mark Thomas is setting himself up to maybe repeat with another world championship, but not if number two, Scott Wise, has anything to say about it.
Our next stop on the IHRA Trail will be the Snap-on Tools Mid-America Nationals from the Nebraska Motorplex August 29th at 12 p.m. Eastern Time. ESPN Speed World coverage of the Caribe Sun Care Products Nitrous Nationals has been brought to you by Quaker State.